Recorded Books presents When a Brown Girl Flees by Aamna Qureshi, narrated by Fareeda Pasha. Trigger warnings. Depression, anxiety, emotional abuse, physical abuse, self-harm, suicidal ideation, slut-shaming, PTSD. If you are struggling or in crisis, help is available. Call or text 988 or visit 988lifeline.org for support and resources. Author's note. I first wrote this book in the spring of 2016, when I was a senior in high school and going through a lot of the aches and pains Zahra is going through. I was dealing with a lot of the same confusions and discomforts that accompany growing up. Everything seemed like a question mark. Everything hurt. I didn't know how to navigate this world as a teenage girl, as a Muslim, as a Pakistani American, as a hijabi, as a daughter, as anything. I felt so pressured, as teens on the precipice of adulthood often do, to know everything. Thus, the not knowing, wretched enough, was made twice so by everyone's expectations and my inability to fulfill them. When I started writing this book, I truly had no idea how it would end. I didn't know what answers to give my main character because I didn't have the answers myself. But somehow, during the process of writing, the answers came to me, and I was able to grow alongside my characters. I hope, too, that this book gives you answers. This story is a love letter to oneself. It's the type of book I wish I could have read when I was growing up, and it's the type of book I hope brings healing and clarity to whoever reads it. While I took great care in crafting this story and hope that I handled the sensitive topics therein with delicacy, please forgive me if you feel I mishandled any aspect of this book. The last thing in the world I want to do is cause anyone pain, especially with my words. All my love, Aamna. Chapter 1. It was an ordinary Monday when I left. June 27th, 2 days after graduation, 12 days before the wedding. I was driving past the train station on my way home from my tutoring job, my mouth cold from an iced caramel latte, my hands sticky with sweat, music playing on the radio. It was summer music, easygoing and upbeat, coaxing listeners to move with the rhythm. The weather was blazing, the sun scorching, and I saw shirtless boys riding bicycles, their laughter carefree in the wind. An ordinary summer day. The summer after senior year was meant for relaxation, to find myself before college. It was meant for all the mental sorting I needed to do before stepping on the path toward a new life. I was supposed to form healthy habits, watch the sunrise, drink good coffee, spend time with friends. I was meant to garden and read and cook and breathe and live. No internships, no summer job, no homework. Freedom. But I would experience none of these things. The thought of leaving came to me while I was stopped at a red light. I had another 5 minutes before Ummi would call, wondering precisely how far from home I was. 5 more before she called again to double-check, then 10 before I was grounded. I turned to look out the window. There it was, the train station I passed every day. I had only ever been on the train once before, on a school-chaperoned trip to San Francisco from where we lived in Sunnyvale. What if? But my thoughts were elusive, and I gave no words to them in my mind. I simply turned on my blinker and switched into the empty lane beside me in a daze. Faintly, I told myself, you'd never dare. Faintly, I thought I'd turn back the instant I entered the parking lot. Brown kids didn't just run away. But I found myself parking, then pulling the key out of the ignition. Thoughts swarmed my mind, incoherent buzzing turning into pro-con lists and consequences. I closed the door to my thoughts and opened the door to the car. It didn't seem real, like when you know you're mucking up a drawing, but you keep scribbling anyway, knowing full well you could toss it and start again. I grabbed my bag and stepped out of my car. My phone rang. Ummi, the screen read, vibrating in my hand as I held it. My finger hovered over the accept button. Then, the ringing ceased. My body was fluid, dreamlike. I felt nothing. I turned my phone off and dropped it onto the seat, then slipped my keys into the sunglasses holder. Nothing. I went to the kiosk and bought a train ticket. I got on the train, my bag bumping against my leg as I walked down the aisles. Nothing. I sat. Still nothing. Then the train began to move. My breath was sucked out of me in a clean swoop, anxiety filling my lungs. I suddenly stood up. Blood pounded in my ears, too loud and too fast. I curled my toes, fighting against the anxiety, holding it back. Breathe, I thought, breathe. I forced myself to take a breath. Get it together. What the hell? I loosened the stiff muscles of my fingers, spread my toes flat, and straightened my back from its crumpled state. Inhale for 7, hold for 6, exhale for 8. Inhale for 7, hold for 6, exhale for 8. Kiawa, what's wrong? My thoughts alternated between Urdu and English. Kiawa. Nothing. Nothing was wrong, but everything was. The realization of what was happening hit me suddenly, that this was real. Not a dream, that this was life, not a piece of paper I could toss. I argued with myself, get off the train, say it's an emergency. There had to be an emergency brake somewhere, like in the movies. No, you are not getting off this train, you are leaving Pago, run, run, run. But I didn't want to go. I wanted to go home, curl up in my lavender-scented sheets, listen to the sound of Geo News coming from Baba's office, and smell roti cooking downstairs. I wanted to wonder when my older brother Ehsan would come home, knock at my bedroom door to see if I was asleep, then come in to talk when he saw that I wasn't. But I couldn't go home. Not to have Ummi yell at me the instant I walk through the door, not to have to stand there silently and take it, not to have Baba come in asking, "Kya shor macha rahe? What is this noise?" I couldn't watch Ehsan come home smelling like weed, eyes red-rimmed and face dazed. I couldn't go home, but I wanted to. I needed to go home, but I didn't want to. All these thoughts whirled in my mind, splitting me in half to argue each side, as if I were two people, debating my fate. It was a civil war, and all the casualties were mine. I lost both ways. I won both ways. I wished for time to stop, to still, for the world to go frozen. I closed my eyes, pushing away the feeling of the train moving beneath me, the smell of public transportation. My senses stripped away, layer by layer, until there was silence, until there was nothing. And then, all I could hear was Ami's voice, broken and raw, yelling, "How could you? How could you?" Over and over, and it made me want to rip my heart out of my chest, knowing I caused her that pain, knowing those tears were because of me, knowing that anger in her eyes was directed at me. If only I could take it back. If only I could rewind. I opened my eyes. It didn't matter. I couldn't hurt her anymore, and she couldn't hurt me. No more would we be each other's misery. I was leaving, Mibhagriyu, and that was it. Everything will be better, I told myself. You couldn't stay, I reminded myself. Yaad nahi hai, kya hone wala tha? Don't you remember what was going to happen? Months after winter break, I was given two options. Zahra, idhar aao. Ami had called me to her room one day. It was her serious voice, which meant, don't speak, not until I am through, and even then, at your own caution. It meant, I am angry. It meant, your feelings do not matter. It meant, you will obey. I always did. Always. Gee, hands tucked behind my back, teeth nibbling on my lip, eyes empty. Dekho, she said, sitting down in front of me. I'm giving you two options. Ya to main tumhara rishta dhundu, or tumhari shadi ho isi summer mein, ya tum doctor ban jao. It's your choice. Ammi, kya matlab shadi ya doctor? I asked, but it was futile. What do you mean I get married or become a doctor? We Parachas were a stubborn lot, and once a decision was made, it was written in stone, no erasures. Ami smiled then, her lips twisted in disgust, eyes hard. Words were poised in her defiant eyes, and I knew what she would say. Ashamed, I interjected before she could. Acha. Tike, I nodded. Can I have some time to decide, please? Graduation tak. 2 months. Ami always won. No matter how soft she seemed on the exterior, her interior was solid, yet to thaw. It was frozen still from January, frozen still from the catalyst that divided my life into before and after. I needed time, time to think, time to breathe, time to be. Without her watching my every move, without her eyes following me wherever I went, like she had been the past few months. I wanted to take a deep breath after months of quiet breathing. After tiptoeing and counting each word, ensuring each was not another spark to ignite my mother's rage. I was so tired. I was so, so tired. On the train, I watched the sunset, orange and pink paint spilling across the horizon, God's brushstrokes. In my heart, I said, Subhanallah, God is magnificent. I said, Alhamdulillah, all praise is due to God. I said, Allahu Akbar, God is great. But it felt like Allah wasn't there. I closed my eyes, and in the darkness, I reached for the light. I reached for the future I had always dreamed of. Chapter 2. I opened my eyes after a while of just being blank. No thoughts, no sleep. Outside the train window, sunset signaled the time for Maghrib, and I knew I should pray. But I wondered if God would even listen after what I had done, what I was doing still. All I felt was a thick fog of melancholy filling my lungs with each breath I took. I was too empty to make dua, to cry to God and plead for forgiveness. I simply sat and nibbled my lower lip, eyes traveling. Two seats down sat a man in a suit, not old, but not young, and our eyes met. He smiled at me, and no matter how benign the gesture, fear burned through my veins. I smiled back to let him know I was not a terrorist, but he quickly averted his gaze. I thought I saw him watching, eyeing this solitary young girl with no father or brother to protect her. The sky swirled into a deep navy blue. It was past dark, and I wasn't home. Guilty tension twisted my stomach. Ami will be livid. With the anxiety came fear, as if any moment now I would be caught and yelled at and broken again. But Ami wasn't here. I was on the train, miles and miles away from home, going even farther, and there was nothing she could do. I felt so worthless, always screwing up, always falling short. At least I wouldn't disappoint them anymore. And I knew deep down Ami would be happy. She would be sad, no doubt, but there would be relief there as well. No more roller coaster of emotions, no more hopes turning to disappointment, no more love, and no more anger. In grief, she would venerate her memory of me, and in those memories, she would live forever content, even with the undercurrent of melancholy. Toh accha hai, I told myself, then it's good. I was going to make a new life and do what I wanted to do. Nobody could stop me. No one, no one, no one. But I still looked over my shoulder. Still felt a phantom hand roughly grabbing my arm and pulling me back, nails digging into my skin. I tried to concentrate on my next move. There was some time until the train reached the city from the suburbs. Where would I go? I could go anywhere. The realization struck me suddenly. My horizons widened. The world suddenly seemed accessible to me, within my grasp. No longer did other countries seem eternities away. Distant continents beckoned me forward, arms open. As swiftly as it came, the excitement dimmed. I usually had everything planned out. Suitcases packed for weeks, carry-on ready with essentials, 2 books to read if I got bored, and my journal to write in if I needed it. But now, I had nothing. Not even my phone. At the very least, I had my wallet, my laptop, and a comfortable outfit on, but it wasn't my favorite, nor my comfiest. I couldn't help but think about all the things I was leaving behind, all my clothes, all my books and trinkets, my jewelry, the comfiest pair of flats, and a bag in the most gorgeous shade of teal. My medals, my vitamins, my deodorant, my hoodies, but no. That was the past, and this was the beginning of a new future, a rebirth. Those mementos would simply remind me of the circumstances, and in the end, the guilt of my past life. Let Ami pass my bedroom every night on the way to hers, I thought bitterly. Let her remember me, smell my perfume, try to catch the ghost of me. Let her miss me, let her hurt, let her suffer. How awful I was to think such things. I wanted to hurt myself for thinking them, but I thought them anyway. I wanted her to hurt as much as I hurt, to miss me as much as I would miss her. I knew not from where this cruelty came, but it was inside me, nestled in my heart. It knocked against my ribs, loud even over the screeching of a halting train, even over the clamor of business calls, laughter and chatter as I exited onto the platform an hour and a half later. San Francisco was the heart of the West Coast, from which all other blood flowed. There was a bus, a train, and just a few miles away, a plane. I could go anywhere. Just a swipe of my card, and I could hop on, no baggage, nothing. Only me. But who was she? I'll go to Boston. I adored it there whenever we visited, but no, I can't. Essen went to school in Boston. Ami had friends there. Baba had colleagues and workmates. Word would get back to Ami before I even had the chance to breathe deeply. And where would I stay? What would I do? Did I even know how much an apartment in Boston cost? Maybe I could go to New York. I'd always loved New York. The gorgeous brownstones, the canopied streets, the towering buildings. 4 months ago, I got into New York University. But Ami refused to send me. I had to stay home and attend the university 15 minutes away for easy access and a monopoly over my weekends. Meanwhile, my older brother Essen was finishing university in Boston, visiting only in the summers and between semesters, if that. But he was a boy. He was allowed to do such things. What the hell am I doing? Sitting in a train station well after dark, wondering where to go? Ami would have already sent Baba out to look for me by now, and it wouldn't take them long to find my car in the train station and put the pieces together. They would find me. I could already feel it, the sting of Ami's hand on my cheek. The air was too hot, too humid, too thick. I couldn't breathe. I had to keep running. I couldn't go back, not now. I grabbed a map from a newsstand. How do I get to the airport? It all looked too complicated. Whenever we came to San Francisco, Baba drove, and we'd arrive in a little over an hour. I had never done anything of this caliber by myself. I looked for somebody to ask for help, but all I saw were busy people quickly walking. "Excuse me," I whispered, trying to grab somebody's attention, but they didn't notice. I felt my voice shrink further. I was on my own. I was alone. I had to figure this out. What if I can't? My vision fogged, and I began hyperventilating. I desperately wished there were somebody to calm me down, somebody to hold my hand, but there was nobody. Inhale for 7, Hold for 6, exhale for 8. Somebody, help somebody. Inhale for 7, hold for 6, exhale for 8. Please, somebody, please help me, please. Nobody came. I stood in the center of the sea, waves crashing over me, pulling me under, vomiting me out, only to take me back down again. Inhale for 7, hold for 6, exhale for 8. I focused on the map and searched for a plausible route. In the end, it was simple. No big deal. It took 40 minutes of stress to get to the airport. Some walking and a bus and the hyper-awareness that I was a little over 5 feet tall and alone, and a girl. If I had been a boy, perhaps I wouldn't have been afraid. What made them so fearless? From birth, boys were cultivated to take on the world, while girls were taught to hold somebody's hand. When Essen was 10, he was allowed to walk half a mile to the park close by, even though he had to cross a main road. When I was 10, I couldn't walk 2 streets down to a school friend's house without Essen by my side. One example of thousands. Since childhood, I had never gone anywhere alone, never dreamed of crossing the street unless I was holding Baba's hand, while Essen would run across the street, arms wide open. I grew up with protective figures in my peripheral and direct lines of sight constantly. Essen galloped freely. Did they love me more, and that's why they were more protective? Impossible. It didn't matter. Now, I was determined to run free, eyes forward, hands caressing the wind. Chapter 3. Until I arrived at the airport, and I had no idea where to go. This was why brown girls don't just run away. How falsely advertised running away was. There were so many technicalities that it gave me a headache. I couldn't simply hop onto a plane. I had to find the right terminal. Weary, I sat down at the coffee shop and pulled out my laptop. I deleted all my social media, already ringing with notifications. Goodbye, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Then I checked my bank account. I had a decent amount of money saved up from tutoring and graduation gifts and Eidi. But where to? I couldn't come up with any destination. I'd never even thought of where I would go if I could. What was the point of imagining my life in Florence, a city I'd always wanted to visit, if I could never end up there anyway? My future was entirely dependent upon whomever I married and where he lived and worked. Like a wave that followed the tide, I had always listened to the ocean of my mother's words, letting them flow through me, never letting my own thoughts stream in their own direction. But if I was doing this, I would do it properly. Maybe I would go to New York. It was the farthest away I could go without leaving the country. 1 foot in, 1 foot out. I couldn't bring myself to leave the country. It felt too much. Too scary, and logistically, it would be more complicated. So, I would go to New York. There was nothing stopping me, no current pulling me in a different direction. It was practical. Still, I was afraid. Essen had traveled across Europe one semester, all alone, and he wasn't perturbed. He went city to city, staying in hostels, roaming the streets, thinking and living. But I could not do that. Tum larki ho, I heard Ami say in my head, as if being a girl was reason enough. I felt the need to be taken care of, for somebody to hold my hand, somebody to guide and protect me as they had been doing my whole life through. I was 18 years old and still couldn't handle being alone. But there was nobody here. I kept checking behind me, half waiting for Ummi to be here, half expecting somebody to catch up with me and ask why I was alone. I was solitary, sticking out like a sore thumb, but nobody noticed. I was just another person, blending into the background of thousands of people going about their lives. I took a steadying breath. I looked up which airline sold tickets to New York, then went to the kiosk with the nicest-looking woman working there. Hi, welcome to Delta. How can I help you? She asked. Can I buy a ticket? I asked, voice sugary, smile toothy and dimpled. It was my white people voice, extra sweet to come across as non-threatening as possible. Of course, the woman said, smiling politely. Where to? New York, I said. I pulled out my wallet and my debit card, grateful I had a separate bank account for my parents. JFK or LaGuardia? The woman asked. I bit my lip. What was the difference? JFK. Would you like nonstop or are layovers okay? Nonstop, please. When would you like to depart? When's the next flight? Unfortunately, there's no more for tonight. The earliest would be tomorrow morning at 11:15 a.m., nonstop. Okay, that's good. Would you like a round-trip ticket or one-way, miss? My smile faltered. Am I coming back? Tears pricked my eyes, my lower lip trembling. One-way is fine, I said, voice thick. The woman's face softened with concern. Blinking fast, I offered her an encouraging smile. That will be $472. Arrival at 8 p.m. Credit or debit? Debit. Enjoy your flight. You too. Thank you. Have a good night. Luckily, I was in the right terminal for my flight. All I had to do was go through security, then wait for the gate to open, then hop on a plane. Since it was a Monday night, the security line wasn't too bad. Luckily, I had an enhanced license, so I could travel domestically without my passport. A few minutes later, I was pulled aside for a random security check. I sighed, adjusting my hijab. A man called two women over, and I was escorted to a separate area behind a curtain. I lifted my arms, and the woman patted me down, hands traveling into each groove to ensure there was nothing hidden. Then began the inquisition. I already had the answers ready, so familiar with them as I was. Where are you going?
New York.
For how long?
A few weeks.
Are you traveling alone?
Yes.
Purpose of travel?
My friend is getting married.
What do you have in your bag? My voice was sweet, smile sure, but my heart ricocheted between my ribs. I expected her to ask me where my parents were or how old I was. Did I look legal? With my chubby cheeks and no makeup on, I knew I didn't. She reached for my bag, and it took her 5 minutes to empty it completely, check for hidden compartments, then nod to herself. She wrote something incomprehensible on my boarding pass, then nodded again. The curtain opened. As I stepped out, I felt the stares of children, adults deliberately looking anywhere but at me. Inside me, I let go of the emotions of excitement and fear and anger and guilt and despair and irritation, stripping them off like layers of clothing after a tiring day. I walked to the right gate, eyes blank, jaw tense. The air conditioning was on too high, my skin was drying. I should have eaten because I hadn't had anything since lunch, but I didn't have the energy or the appetite. I bought a coffee and sipped on it sporadically, slowly, until it got cold and disgusting, but I kept drinking anyway. I usually loved the airport, loved seeing hundreds of families from across the globe in one place, dozens of cultures and sizes and colors and beauty, some tired, some hopeful, some ecstatic, some melancholy. This was humanity, messy and gorgeous. For a moment, I almost began thinking of family trips to the airport, seeing cousins off, receiving grandparents, traveling ourselves. Apathy nudged the thoughts away, however, telling them not to bother me, telling them to hush. Afraid to get robbed, I held my bag in my lap, hugging it, pulling my legs up to encapsulate it. Uncomfortable but tired, I closed my eyes. Flashes of the past few months flitted through my mind like photographs flying in the wind, my nails digging into my skin, choosing an engagement dress, not speaking for days. Fake smiles, nodding, gee on me, okay on me. A ring being slid onto my finger, crying myself to sleep. Slowly, everything faded away,
until there was nothing left but an empty shell of a girl with no voice, no heart, no soul, no mind, nothing, nothing, nothing. Sleep came quickly, despite the early hour in the evening. That night, I did not dream. Chapter 4. One moment I was asleep, the next, jerked awake by an announcement. Flight DL-182 to JFK, now boarding. Sleep damp in my mouth, I rubbed my eyes, stretching my back. There were some people already in line to board my flight, mostly men in suits or mothers with babies. I saw an old Indian woman and her husband in the back, and they reminded me of Nana Abu and Nano. Surprisingly, I wasn't disoriented to wake up in the airport. My back just hurt, a physical feeling I could not ignore. I focused on it. Everything else was surreal. I looked at the time on the screen for the gate and saw it was 10 in the morning. I had slept almost 14 hours, which should have been alarming, but I didn't think about it. I went and stood in line to board. It felt like watching a movie, like I was standing outside my body, watching everything occur. I saw myself hand the attendant my boarding pass and smile as he told me to enjoy my flight. Loneliness lodged in my larynx, an unavoidable lump, rendering me voiceless. I walked through the tunnel, and the blasting air conditioning and the distinct smell of travel brought back memories of every plane ride I could remember. The last one, to Turkey for vacation, and before that, Pakistan, and before that, Morocco, and Pakistan again. Before my failure, when I was the perfect daughter, my life had been so extravagant, so easy. Baba always carrying my suitcase and Essen taking my carry-on when I complained. Mama packing snacks and all of them ushering me forward, carrying me along their tide. While comfort was, in fact, comfortable, I had been so spoiled that it was unnecessarily uncomfortable now to shift from a life of ease toward a life of small difficulties, from a life of dependence to independence. My life had been so full, so why had I felt so empty in it? Even before, there were family and friends, a pretty face, and good grades. We were well off. We always had enough to eat and good things to buy. Inside me, there was a valley between what I felt and the happiness that was expected of me, and I wasn't sure when it got there, what glacier carved it into my soul. All I knew was that it was ever growing. It had been ever since March when I had told Ami I decided to get married. She'd been happy. It was a step forward. But I was a wilted flower. And with each day that passed, I lost another petal, until I was a rotting stem from which nothing could grow. I boarded the plane and found my seat in silence. When was the last time I spoke? My breath tasted old, but I didn't have a toothbrush. I was in the same clothes as yesterday. I set my bag down, melting into invisibility. Fright crept through me. Every time somebody entered the compartment, I expected it to be somebody looking for me. I was as jumpy as a felon, which felt accurate, for it was a crime for brown girls to disobey their families. It was a felony for them to run away. Somebody sat next to me, and I turned to see a young guy a few years older than me. He was good-looking. Despite his appeal, I squirmed. All I wanted was to sit next to an old woman or a girl my age, anybody kind and placid and non-threatening. He settled into his seat. I must have looked frenzied because he gave me a strange look. I forced a smile that manifested more like a grimace and turned my attention away. However, in my peripheral vision, I kept my sights on him and he kept looking. Was it because he thought I was cute or because I looked like a terrorist? The woes of being a hijabi. Realistically, it was probably the latter because I looked as shitty as I felt. Despite how much sleep I'd gotten, my clothes were rumpled, my skin was dry, and my hair, although covered, was greasy. Beyond that, I had lost almost 15 pounds in the last 6 months, which maybe didn't sound like a lot, but I was short. It meant I had gotten really skinny to the point of looking sickly. Ironically, I had considered this to be a plus side to the misery of the past months. At least I was finally thin. All my life, I had been plump, and Ummi had been at me to lose weight. She was at least glad I was losing weight for the wedding, as she thought. To me, getting thin was ultimately underwhelming. I thought when I finally got skinny that my life would change for the better, but it didn't. It was just strange. I would wrap my arms around my body and feel how little there was left, feel straight to the bone where before there had been more to me. It was like I was disappearing, even physically. "Where are you headed?" the boy next to me asked, pulling me from my thoughts. He flashed me a charming smile. My eyes must have relayed a stream of question marks because he half laughed. "I mean, in New York."
To visit a friend?
"Cool. My family lives on Long Island."
Okay.
I reached into my bag and pulled my headphones out, but realized too late that I didn't have a phone. Resisting the urge to physically facepalm myself, I pulled my bag into my lap and then stuck the earbuds into my ears, pretending that I had a phone in my bag. "Enjoy your flight," I said, smiling because I was a Muslim and had an image to uphold. As a Muslim, if you treated one person badly, they might blame your entire religion. No pressure, though.
"Thanks,"
the guy half muttered to himself, deflating. I felt guilty. Why did I feel guilty? I didn't owe him my company, and I didn't want to talk. I pulled a blanket up around my shoulders, curling my body into a tight ball and turning my back to him. I nestled into the wall and gazed out the window until the plane began moving and my ears popped. I saw the world as I knew it shrink until I was above the clouds. I took a deep breath. Peace at last. This was a suspension of time. For the next 6 hours, I would be on this plane, and there was nothing to worry about yet because I was on my way to the future. Taking an infinitesimal step closer than I had ever been before, cotton candy clouds filled the sky. It was so beautiful to see them from above, the rounded peaks, the shadows over land far below. I could have stared, mesmerized, for hours at the clouds we passed by, just as I could watch snowfall or fire crackle. Nature was brimming with majesty, and it was so raw and pure that I believed all man-made beauty was surely modeled after the blueprints of Allah's architecture. I was lost in the world so much bigger than I was, lost like a star in the galaxies. I was so small, and the world swallowed me whole. Sometime later, I tried adjusting my legs and collided with another's. I looked down to find that the boy beside me had spread his legs, obliviously infiltrating my personal space. Even after my foot accidentally kicked his ankle, he did not move, impervious. He didn't care. It was a trivial detail, but irritation flashed through me. Sighing, I squeezed into myself, pressing against the wall so there was no physical contact between us, but he didn't seem to notice. I was uncomfortable. The cool air from the window pinched my cheek and nose, but I didn't make a remark or push back. Sticky tears bubbled in my eyes. I wasn't crying, it was just emotion, seeping out in a tangible form. I wiped the tears away with the back of my hand and focused back on the clouds, the perpetual movement of them, the flow of white in an impossibly blue sky. Relaxed, I melted into torpor and eased softly into sleep. I was insatiably tired. I woke hours later, mouth rancid with the aftertaste of slumber. In my sleep, my limbs had unwound and one leg had fallen off the seat. My leg rested against his, our limbs overlapping. Bile flooded my throat, and I tentatively turned my head to look at him. He was asleep, facing me, his head resting on the edge of my seat. I eased my leg back up into my stomach, slowly so as not to wake him, and bit my lip to hold back my revulsion.
He sleepily opened his eyes, and seeing me, smiled politely. I pulled my blanket up around my face again and held back a cry. In another life, it may have been exhilarating to sit next to a cute boy on a plane to have him pay attention to me, but at the moment, it wasn't. Not at all. Abruptly, I stood, jaw set, eyes blank, to get out. I was hyper-aware and paranoid, a hunted, starved animal. He looked up at me and pulled his legs in, but hardly. As I passed through, contact was inevitable. His knees knocked against my thighs, and I nearly toppled into his lap. Bile rose in my throat again. I held it together until I entered the bathroom. The door shut, and something within me burst open. Tears filled my eyes, then overflowed. I quickly brushed them away, wetting my hands in my gray hijab, but it was no use. I began to cry. I was tired of crying, of always being on the verge of tears, a lump perpetually clogging my throat. But I couldn't stop it. The hot tears burning my cheeks, the mucus pouring out of my nose, the feeling that my heart was being held and squeezed and squeezed. Everything within me rattled, and I felt so brittle, on the verge of collapsing. I held my face in my palms, and tears gushed onto my knuckles, into my mouth, salty and sharp. Finally, I looked in the mirror. I didn't recognize who I saw. In my memories, in the photographs and videos, there was a girl with a crooked-toothed grin and chubby cheeks. She always smiled. She always laughed. In her dark brown eyes, there was light. Who is she? I couldn't reconcile her with who I was now. That girl was me, but I didn't feel like her. Not anymore. I wondered what happened to her. I missed her. I was envious of her. I wondered when I became someone else. When I looked in the mirror now, all I saw were sullen cheeks, a clenched jaw, apathetic eyes, and snarling lips. There was death smoldering beneath my skin, turning it gray, like I was a corpse rotting within myself. The instant I left the bathroom, I collided with a flight attendant. Her eyes filled with alarm. "Oh," she cried, hand flying to her heart. "Is everything all right?" I shook my head, eyes filling with tears again. I didn't trust myself to speak without melting into sobs. "What's the matter?" she asked, pulling me aside. A comforting hand fell to my shoulder. I felt 8 rather than 18. I rubbed my eye with a fist and sniffed. Can you change my seat? "If you can, it's okay," I stuttered. "Of course, darling," she responded. "Why, is somebody bothering you? We can file a report together." Her countenance shifted into a no-nonsense disposition as her eyes hardened and her lips straightened. "No, oh my God, no, I want to be alone for a bit," I stammered. The flight attendant's eyes softened. "I understand, honey. Luckily, the flight's half empty. Follow me." "Let me grab my bag," I said. Setting my jaw, I walked back to my aisle. When he saw me approach, he lifted his legs back slightly to let me through. "Could you hand me my bag, please?" He pulled out his earbud and I repeated myself. Nodding, he reached over and offered it to me. To avoid any finger brushing, I awkwardly held it from the bottom. I met the flight attendant, and she led me to an empty row in the back cabin. Because it was a Tuesday morning, it wasn't difficult to switch my seat. "Thank you so much," I whispered to her, eyes tearing again at her kindness. She shook her head and smiled a dazzling smile. "Don't worry about it. If you need anything, let me or one of the other girls know," she told me. I offered her a turn of my lips, trying my best to smile. Then I was alone. I didn't need to put up any facade. Loneliness was like an old pair of socks I should have gotten rid of ages ago. Though worn and slightly scratchy, they were somehow comfortable despite the discomfort. Hours later, my ears were popping again, and my stomach was flopping as we landed. People filed into the aisles, grabbing their bags and their children. There was a funnel surrounding my sight, blocking off anything that didn't have to do with myself. I clutched my bag and ran off the instant I could. Technicalities ensued, boring and seemingly endless. Still, I felt the prickly fear of being alone, the disheartening discomfort of having to do everything myself, but finally, finally, I exited the terminal. There were families and escorts and people with signs, but nobody for me. So I walked, watching my swollen brown feet move in my sandals across the white tile until I reached the door. A little voice whispered in my ear, "Brown girls don't just run away. Go back. Go back." I thrust open the door, and there it was, New York, a world away from the home that was no longer my home. Chapter 5. What struck me first was the air, pollution mixed with rain and smoke. It tasted different, and it was definitely chillier. What struck me next was the hour. Darkness had already descended, swirls of spilled navy ink. The East Coast was 3 hours ahead, I recalled. New York seemed like an entirely different country. For a moment, I felt the bliss that came from visiting an unseen land. Standing in JFK almost felt like home. I heard aunties speaking Urdu, I saw hijabis and men with long beards and people dressed in shalwar kameez. There were children leaping into the arms of family members, their laughter filling the air like ringing bells. It almost made me smile, until I thought about my parents. I couldn't even remember how long it had been since we were happy with one another. Goodness toward parents was obligatory in Islam. There was a hadith, a prophetic saying, that heaven lies beneath the feet of one's mother. Tearing my eyes away from the happy families, I looked around, trying to figure out where to go from there. I saw a sign leading to the air train, which dropped passengers off at Jamaica train station. From there, it connected West Manhattan or east to the Long Island Railroad. The idea of New York City frightened me. It was dangerous there, and I'd always been a suburban girl. Plus, I missed the ocean already. So I headed to the air train, bought a metro card, and boarded with everyone and their luggage. At Jamaica, I got off and bought a ticket at the kiosk for the LIRR, going toward Port Jefferson, the last stop. According to the map, it was right by the water. I guessed I could get off there. It seemed as good a place as any. When the train came, I boarded in a daze. Clutching my bag to my chest, I stared out the window, looking for stars. There were so many floating in the rich, cloudless sky. I felt like I could drink it all up, like I could reach out and catch the stars like fireflies. I wondered what it would be like to have wings, to have a perpetual light inside me. Wondered what it would be like to fly. I watched and wondered for a while as we passed through various towns and suburbs. Since it was dark, I couldn't make out much, but it didn't look too different than the suburbs I was used to. Sleep stole over me once more, despite how much I had already slept. I let it drown me in its darkness until the train reached the end of the line at Port Jefferson. I piled off the train with everyone else, but unlike them, I had no car waiting for me. Thankfully, there was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.